Hello guys, and welcome back to the IGCSE Computer Science channel. This is another video tutorial for Unit 3. And this unit, as you guys all know, from the IGCSE Computer Science curriculum, it basically focuses on logic gates and circuits. In this chapter, we'll be learning how to basically understand first what logic gates are, what logic circuits are, and then we'll be understanding the purpose of having logic gates and circuits within the internal components or circuits of a computer system. We will also be constructing and learning what true tables are, which basically are used to display the output of a logic circuit, and we are also going to learn how to write Boolean algebra. So let's begin, guys. So this is chapter 3. If you guys have not been following my video tutorials, please look at the previous video tutorials for chapter 1 and 2, and you would understand why we're currently in chapter 3. So electronic circuits within the computer system or other digital devices or many memories are basically made up of thousands of logic gates. And these logic gates basically take binary input to produce binary output. So several logic gates combine to form logic circuits. And these circuits are designed to perform specific purposes. So if you want to understand this technically or basically, you would say the computer system or any electronic or digital device is made up of thousands of internal circuits. And these internal circuits are the ones that do the job of interpreting instructions or inputs that they receive, of course, from the user, which is then converted into binary and then producing some sort of output, which is a binary output, which is then converted again back into data that the user can understand on the screen, of course. So the checking of the output from a logic circuit or a logic gate is usually done using a truth table, which is what we're going to be looking at in this chapter. There are also a number of possible applications of logic circuits where they can be applied and used. And in this chapter, you would also be referring to the use of Boolean algebra. So to get started, if you look at the logic gates, there are 6 different types of logic gates that you will be looking at in this chapter. And this is also very similar to the IB computer science curriculum when you are looking at logic gates and circuits. The only difference is the representation. How you represent these gates is slightly different in IB computer science than in IGCSE. So for the IGCSE computer science curriculum, you'll be looking at the 6 different logic gates. And these gates are the NOT gate, the AND gate, the OR gate, the NAND gate, and the NOR gate, and the XOR gate. Over time, while we're doing this chapter, you're going to get used to understanding and recognizing these gates since there are just 6 of them. And they kind of tend to repeat themselves to create logic circuits. So we need to remember that these are just the 6 gates that we have for logic gates. Now, what we also have to think about are the truth tables. One thing that you'll be seeing in this chapter, like I mentioned, is what are the logic gates exactly, how they combine to form logic circuits, and how you can construct a logic circuit diagram, and of course, how you can construct a truth table that basically displays the output of the logic circuit, which basically displays the logic that is within the circuit, that is what the circuit is supposed to do. And this would normally go to like controlling robots. Robots, for example, when you have a robotic device, you have a remote control, you're able to press any buttons to move the robot forward, backward, which was something we have seen as well in chapter 1, if you recall, or I think it was chapter 2. So basically that logic of having the robot or any electronic device to move back and forth, that control is done by logic circuits. And they're the ones that take the input, which you press on the remote control that is converted into binary to produce a binary output, which you then see on your, you know, you then see displayed in front of you, whether it's in a screen or in the device itself. So truth tables are very useful to trace the output of a logic gate or circuit. And the NOT gate, which we just saw above, is the only gate with one input. All the other gates have 2 inputs. And we're going to see that very shortly. When constructing a truth table, all possible combinations of ones and zeros are considered as the input. So what I want to say here is, whenever you are constructing a truth table, you always have the inputs, and these inputs are represented with 1 and 0. So basically, 1 would be a state of, like you'd say, on. So 1 is going to be a state of on, and then 0 is going to be a state of off. So this is pretty much how it is interpreted. So 1s and 0s for any logic gate. Now for the NOT gate, since it has one input, that means 2 raised to the power of 1. Since it takes binary inputs, then we have to do with the powers of 2. So 2 raised to the power of 1, since the NOT gate contains only one input, will give you 2 possible combinations. So a 0 and a 1. For the other gates, they have 2 inputs, so that means 2 raised to the power of 2, which basically gives you 4 possible binary combinations. For logic circuits, the number of inputs can be more than 2. So we were talking about the logic gates, and we said the NOT gate basically has 1 input, which means 2 raised to the power of 1, and all the other gates have 2 inputs, which means 2 raised to the power of 2, which gives you a 4 possible binary combination. But when we are talking about logic circuits, and that means when you combine the logic gates together, then we are expecting to have more than 2 inputs, of course, because you're combining more than one gate. So you could have, for example, 2 raised to the power of 3. You could have 3 inputs, so 2 raised to the power of 3, which is going to give you 8 binary combinations. Or you could have 2 raised to the power of 4, which gives you 4 different binary combinations. Well, I mean, 16 different binary combinations. So it is clear that the number of possible binary combinations is basically the multiple of 2 in every case. Now, there is a trick here, and I find sometimes students get confused when you are given a logic circuit diagram and you are asked to create a truth table for the diagram, and you know and you are able to see the number of inputs, but students often get confused as how many zeros and ones should they have in each input column. So I'm going to try and help solve this dilemma today. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take a screenshot of this table and this table of inputs, which basically truth table show you that their first table on the left has 2 inputs, the one in the middle has 3, and the one on the right has 4. So how are they able to successfully divide the zeros and ones between these inputs? So I'm going to place the screenshot that we just took over here. All right, so now let's look at these truth tables carefully. Now, what you can observe, if you look at the first truth table on the left, you can observe that there are 2 inputs, and these inputs are basically A and B. And what we know is if we want to determine the number of zeros and ones we're going to be having in each column, then we have to do 2 raised to the power of the number of inputs, which in this case is 2, and that gives us 4. So what I normally tell my students to do is, since it gives you 4 possible binary combinations and there are just 2 inputs, you divide that 4 by 2. And so that tells you how many zeros and ones you're going to have in the first column of the first input. So if you divide 4 by 2, it gives you 2. And so that means you're going to have 2 zeros and then 2 ones. And then you keep dividing until you don't get anything else to divide. Basically, you get 1. So since you have 2, you've solved how many zeros and ones you're going to have in the first input column, which is A. You're going to divide the 2 again by another 2, and so you're going to get 1. And so that tells you how many zeros and ones you're going to have in the second input, which in this case is going to be 1, 0 and 1, 1. So that's pretty much how I always advise my students to get the number of zeros and ones rightly, which is what we have here in the second input B. If you look at the middle table, which is the one that contains 3 inputs, we know to be able to determine the number of binary combinations, we have to do 2 raised to the power of 3. So whatever amount of binary combinations, whatever amount of inputs they give you to construct a truth table for, they give you in a logic circuit, you just raise it to the power of 2. So in this case, there are 3 inputs, which we have A, B, and C. And to determine the number of zeros and ones you're going to have in each input column, you first get the 2 raised to the power, whatever number of inputs you have, which is 8. And then you divide the first result by 2. So that gives you 4, which means you're going to have 4 zeros and 4 ones in the first input column, which is what we have here, 1, 2, 3, 4. And that means 4 ones as well. So 1, 2, 3, 4. And then you divide this again to get the second column input, which in this case is B, and so you get 2. So that means you're going to have 2 zeros and 2 ones, and all of that would fit until the end of this table, of course. And then again, you divide it until you no longer can divide and you get 1. So finally, you're going to have 1, 0 and 1, 1. So this is way easy to always make sure you're putting the number of zeros and ones correctly in each input column. And so the same thing happens to the 4 inputs. Again, 2 raised to the power of 4 is 16. So 16 divided by 2, which means you're going to get 8. So that means 8 zeros and 8 ones in the first column, which is what we have here. So I'm not going to move on to keep explaining this, the concept, keep applying, but this is one way I will always taught my students how to be able to get the right number of inputs in these particular columns for the zeros and ones. So I hope this was a helpful strategy for you as well. Now, moving on, we're going to move to the next thing. And now this is the most important thing. We have to understand the logic of the output for every logic gate. So first, we're going to be looking at the first gate, which is the NOT gate, and we're going to be focusing on the functions and the output for each gate, what you're expected to get for each of these gates. For the NOT gate, remember, it's the only one that has one input, as you can see in this diagram here. So A is the input, which just basically produces the X. The rule for the NOT gate is that the output X, which you can see here on the right side, is 1 if the input is 0. So if the input A is 0, on this side is 0, then the output is going to be 1. If the input A is a 1, then the output is going to be a 0. So it's basically the opposite. So that's what the NOT is about. So in this case, if A input is 0, then output is going to be 1. Like I said, if A input is 1, then output is going to be 0. How do we represent this in a logical notation? Because again, during the exams or during a test you might have in class, your teacher or the exam question might ask you to represent the logic circuit using logical notation. And logical notation, you should not confuse it with Boolean algebra. They're two different things. With a logical notation, if you want to represent the NOT gate, you just write the capital NOT in front of the input you're trying to represent it for. So in this case, X is equal to NOT A, and so this is the logical representation. However, with a Boolean algebra, you have to put a sort of like bar on top of the input, which is this line bar. I like to call it the inversion sign, just like in math. So it's like an inversion sign or a negation sign, which sometimes I like to use as well. This is a negation sign. So this would basically mean not A. So you could do it this way, or you could also do it with the A and a bar, which is the ideal one that is normally done. And it still represents the same thing as not A. So this is the logical notation, of course. And then the one on the other side is what we call the Boolean algebra. So this is logical notation. And then this one here is considered as the Boolean algebra. So Boolean algebra. Okay, so please don't confuse the two of them. They are not the same. Okay, so they're pretty much different. So this is Boolean algebra and this is logical notation. Okay, going back. So this is the rule for the NOT gate. And this is how you write the NOT gate using logic notation or Boolean algebra. With the AND gate, again, this is how the gate looks like. So with the AND gate and any other logic gate, they have two inputs, unlike the NOT gate. So in this case, you can see input A and B. And of course, that's going to give you X. And this is how we draw the AND gate. So the rule for this is that the output X is 1 if both inputs A and B are 1. So for the output to be 1, both of the A and B inputs have to be 1. And guys, remember to consider the 1 as anything on, just like when instructions are sent or inputs are received in the internal components of a computer, when you press a key or any of that sort, you type something. All of that are inputs that are received and are processed by this logic circuits made up of logic gates. And so they receive this binary input and process the binary output. So this is why these rules of these logic gates have to apply. The logic circuits are based on the rules that are applied for each gate. So for the AND gate, both inputs have to be 1 for the output to be 1. So if you construct a truth table for this, you have the column of the inputs and the outputs like we've seen. And of course, you have your inputs written down, which is A and B, and then your output X. So since it is two inputs, that means 2 raised to the power of 2, which is 4 possible binary combinations. If you divide 4 by 2, you get 2 zeros and 2 ones on the first column. You divide 2 again, you get 1, 0, and 1, 1. Now you need to determine the output. So what we have on the first row here is A is 0 and B is 0. And remember, the rule of the AND gate says both A and B have to be 1 for the output to be 1. Since we have 0 and 0, the output is going to be a 0. Again, where we have 0 and 1, it says both of them have to be 1. So this is not both, 0 and 1. The output is going to be 0 again. Again, here we have on the third row, 1 and 0. The output again is going to be 0. The only situation where we have the output is 1 is where both A and B are 1, which in this situation, 1, 1. And so we get the output as 1. So this is the rule for the AND gate. Now, how do we represent the AND gate? If you're using the logical notation to represent the AND gate, then it's going to be A and B. So you write the inputs and you put the AND statement or keyword in the middle between them with a capital. So this is the logic notation. However, if you're writing it in Boolean algebra, then you write the A and B. You can write it with an uppercase. It doesn't necessarily have to be lower cases. But as long as you put the A and B, in this case, since there are two inputs, you need to put a dot between the inputs to signify that it's an AND gate. So this would be A and B in this case. Now for the OR gate, this is the representation of how the OR gate looks like. And again, we have the A and B inputs and we have the X as the output. So the OR gate basically means A or B, which is going to produce the output of X. The rule for the OR gate is that the output X is 1 if either A or B is 1. So always remember, for AND gate, both of them had to be 1. For OR gate, they basically mean either one of them should be 1 for the output to be 1. So if you were constructing a truth table, again, because this has also two inputs, you have 4 possible binary combinations, so which is why you have your zeros here and your ones in this order. Now, the output is going to give you a different output because the rule is different. The rule for the OR gate states that either one of the inputs could be 1 for the output to be 1. So if you look at the first row, A is 0 and B is 0, so none of them are 1, so that means the output is going to be a 0. A is, for the second row, A is 0 and B is 1, so that means it applies to the rule. One of them is 1, which is B, so the output is going to be 1. And again, the fourth row, A is 1 and then B is 0. Again, one of them is 1, so the output is going to be 1. And finally, even when they are two 1s, as long as it meets the rule where either of them should be a 1, the output is still going to be a 1. So essentially, this is the result for the OR gate. Now, how you represent the OR gate in a logical notation is you put A, well, you put the inputs in between them. If they're connected with the OR gate, you write the OR gate with a capital letter OR. And then again, in Boolean algebra, instead of using the dot to represent them for the AND gate, this time for the OR gate, use a plus sign to represent the relationship between the two inputs in the gate, which are connected using OR gate. Now, NAND gate basically is another gate, and this gate just translates into not AND gate. So if you guys remember, the AND gate didn't have the circle in the front, but with the NAND gate, because it says not AND gate, so it has a circle in the front. So this is where it is a little bit different from its original representation. So the description is that the output X is 1 if input A and B are not both 1. So what does that mean? So if A and B are not both 1, that is the only time that X, which is the output, is going to be 1. So again, with the NAND gate, we have, again, two inputs, which is A and B. And so that means 2 raised to the power of 2, 4 possible binary combinations. And so that means in our first input row column, we have 0, 0, 1, 1. And in our second input column, we have 0, 1, 0, 1. Now the output, since it says that the output can only be 1 if inputs A and B are not both 1, so as you can see for the first one, if you say A and B, remember that the AND rule is going to give you a 0. But because this is not AND, the output is going to give you a 1, so it's the opposite. Again, where we have A is 0 and B is 1, again, because it is 0 and 1, if with a normal AND gate you're supposed to get a 0, but because it's not AND, it gives you 1. The same thing here, for 1 and 0, with a normal AND gate, it's going to give you a 0, but because it's not AND, so it gives you a 1. And here, where we have 1, 1, with a normal AND gate, it's supposed to give us an output of 1, but because it's not AND, it gives you an output of 0. So how can we write the notation, the logical notation for the NAND gate? Well, we write it using A NAND B, so we put the NAND in capitals, of course, between the inputs that are basically connected using the NAND gate. And then to write it into Boolean algebra, we again represent the dots between the inputs to signify the AND. The only difference is we put a bar or a negation symbol, a bar at the top or a negation symbol at the side. So it could be written as well as this. So you could do it A dot, so this is A and B, but not A and B. So this is basically the NAND gate as well. So you're using the negation symbol here to represent this, or you could put the bar at the top. So this is the NAND gate. Now we go into the NOR gate. The NOR gate is exactly the same as the AND gate. It applies to the same rule, only this is not OR. So whatever is the rule for the OR gate, the opposite of that. So this is how the OR gate looks like, just like the NAND gate. There is a circle in the front of the OR gate, and there are the two inputs to give you the output X. The rule for the OR gate says that the output X is 1 if neither the input A or B nor B is 1. So if neither of them is 1, then the output can be 1. So if we look at the truth tables, again, we have our possible 4 possible binary combinations. The rule, remember, if this was an A or B, because it's or 0 or 0, we're supposed to get a 0 normally. But because this is a NOR gate, so not that, we get a 1. Not 0 is a 1. Again, here, if you remember with the OR gate, if it was a 0 or 1, we're supposed to get a 1. But because it's a NOR gate, not 1, so it gives you a 0. The same thing applies on the third row. A is 1 and B is 0. So with the OR gate, we're supposed to get basically a 1. But because this is a NOR gate, we get a 0. And the same thing applies for the last row. A is 1, B is 1. If it is A or B, we're supposed to get a 1. But NOR that, we're getting a 0. So how we represent this is we say A nor B in the logical representation. We write the nor in capitals again. And then in Boolean algebra, we basically write a plus, which is the symbol for OR gate. But this time we put a bar at the top. And then lastly is the XOR gate. So the XOR gate basically is the opposite of all of the gates. It looks like this, where the two bars on the curvy lines on the side here on the right side. And of course, we have our two inputs again in our output X. So the rule for the XOR gate, it says that the output X can be 1 if A is 1, input A is 1, and input B is 0. Or if input A is 0 and input B is 1. Basically, this is the rule for the XOR gate. So what it's saying is either one of the inputs should be 1 for the output X to be 1. If both inputs are 1, it still doesn't mean it's going to be 1. So don't think if A is 1 and B is 1, it's going to be 1. No, if A and B is 1, it's going to be 0. The rule only applies if one of the inputs is 1, then the output can be 1. So this is a situation why they said if the input A is the one that is going to be the 1 and B is going to be 0, the output is going to be 1. If input B is going to be the one with the 1 and A is going to be 0, it's still going to give you an output of 1. So again, we have our 4 possible binary combinations. And here we have 0, X, or 0. That's going to give you 0 because it doesn't apply to the rule. Here we have 0 and X or 1. So of course it does apply because in this situation, A is 0 and B is 1. So it gives you a 1. Here we have again X, 1, X or 0. So it still gives you a 1. But in a situation where we have 1, X or 1, it gives you a 0. How we represent this is to show A X or. So we write the X or in capitals between the inputs, and so we get this result. And also in Boolean algebra, if we wanted to write the X or gate, it's slightly different from the other ones. So in this case, it shows X is equal to A dot B with a bar at the top plus A with a bar at the top dot B. So one of them, so this is showing you that one of them is not a 1, which in this case on the left, B is not a 1. And then, of course, on the right, A is not a 1. So this is the Boolean algebra representation of the XOR gate. Or sometimes it is also written as A or B and A and not, well, and NAND AB. So that's again, so that what they're trying to say is that this Boolean algebra that is, you can see my mouse moving over, is the same as this. So sometimes it's written in either one of these to represent the Boolean algebra of the XOR gate. Now there is a short activity here. It says that we should find out why they actually say that A and not B or not A and B is the same as A or B and A and B not, or not A and B. So they're saying find out why this Boolean algebra here is the same as this when it says it's sometimes written as that. So obviously, if you wanted to find out why this Boolean algebra for XOR gate is the same as this representation, even though they look totally different, but they still produce the same output, then you're going to have to construct a truth table for that, which we're going to do in a few minutes. So here it says, note tree symbols in the Boolean algebra have the following meaning. This dot represents the AND operation. The plus represents the OR operation. A bar above the letter, for example, not A, represents the not operation. So let's try to do this first part activity here. It says that we need to prove y. So it's like you're doing a mathematical proof. So you're doing yx equal to A. So we're going to write it A and not B, or I think it was with an or not A. So not A and B. So we're supposed to prove why this whole thing is equal to the same thing as x is equal to A or B, so which is again the same representation for the XOR gate. Remember, this is the XOR gate representation or notation in Boolean algebra. So why this is the same as equal to A or B, and then we have and NAND AB. So NAND AB, of course, will be A and B not. So why is it the same? So we're supposed to prove this. One way we can prove this, of course, the only way is we definitely have to construct a logic circuit, but we also have to see how many inputs we have. So in the first Boolean algebra, we have two inputs. So that's 2^2. So that means we need 4 possible binary combinations. In the second Boolean algebra equation, or should I say, yeah, I like to call it equation sometimes, we also have 2 inputs. So that means 2^2, which means 4 possible binary combinations. So that means if we represent, we create a truth table for the first representation. So that's going to give us an A and a B. We draw the line. So this is how you'd create a truth table. We know we're supposed to get 4 possible binary combinations. So we're going to divide 4 by 2 so we know how many zeros we need on the first column of the input. So if you divide 4 by 2, you're going to get 2. So that means we're going to need 2 zeros and 2 ones. So 0, 0, and 1, 1. Then we further divide 2 again by 2, and so we get 1 again. So that means until we get this 1, we stop. So that means we're going to get 1, 0, and 1, 1 on the second input. It's always nice to draw a line if you're starting this, like this is your first time, so that you don't make a mistake when you're trying to combine the inputs to determine the output at the beginning. And of course, later on, you would get accustomed to the way things work, so you don't need the lines. So again, because we get 1 at the second input, so that means on the second input column, we're going to have 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 0, and then 1, 1. So this is what we have. So we've now constructed these input zeros and ones. The next thing we're going to look is at the Boolean algebra and look what we need from this Boolean algebra. Well, we have already A, so we don't necessarily need to do an A again. So just check off what you already have on your truth table. So we already have an A. We don't need to do an A. We don't have a negation B, I mean a not B, so we need to do that. We also don't have a not A. We need to also create a colon for that. That's basically what you do. You check off. But we have a B colon, so we don't need to do that. So we create a colon for A and not B. So we basically do this with a line at the top. And then we create another colon for not A and B. And so once we've done this, now we can kind of get the results. So we know that not, remember, is the opposite of what the input is. So if we want to look at A and B, so we have our A here, but it says A and not B. So what we're going to do is, I wanted to say that we don't have it. So let's do it. Sorry. I wanted to do this first. I made a mistake. We need to do the inputs that we don't have that I said we need to check off. So we'll do the not A because we don't have that one. Then we'll do the not B. So this is easier to understand for a first timer. So we'll do the not B. We put the bar at the top. Then we can do this A and not B because we have the equation. Now that we have the not B's and not A's. And then we can do the A, not A, and B. And then finally, we could do the X. So I'm sorry if this is kind of like the end here, but I hope you guys can see. So we do the X, and the X basically means these two things connected with the OR gate, okay? Now, we need to do not A. So not A means whatever is the input for A, the opposite of that. So in the first part, we have a 0. So that means not 0, it's a 1. Not 0, it's a 1. Not 1 is a 0, and then not 1 is a 0. So this is the output for not A. Then we're going to do the output for not B. So the output for not B is going to be a 0. Not 0 is going to be a 1. Not 1 is going to be a 0. And of course, not 0 is going to be a 1. And then, of course, not 1 is going to be a 0 as well. So this is the output for not B. Now we're going to do A and not B. So since we already have gotten these outputs, we're going to do A and not B. So that means we're going to be looking at this part here, A, and we're going to be looking at the not B and connecting them with this AND gate. So A in the first part is 0, and then AND 1 is going to give you a 0, of course, because the AND gate says both of them have to be a 1 for the output to be a 1. So again, we have a 0 and the 0, so we're going to get a 0. And then, so I hope you guys know we're looking at just the A and the not B part. And then we have a 1 and a 1, so we get a 1 as our output. And then we have a 1 and a 0, and then we're going to get, of course, with the AND gate rule, we still get a 0 because both of them have to be 1s for the output to be 1. And then now we're going to be looking at the next part of the equation, which is not A and B. So we're going to be looking at not A. I'm just going to change the color so you see not A and B. So now we're going to focus on these two things. So not A was 1 and B, which was 0. Again, the AND gate states that both of them have to be 1s for the output to be 1. So this is a 0 and a 1. So it's going to be an output of 0. Here we have a 1 and a 1. So yes, both of them are 1s. And with the AND gate, the rule says the output can be 1 if both are 1. Here we have a 0 and a 0. So it's going to be a 0. Here we have a 1 and a 0. Again, one of them is not 1, so it's going to be a 0. So this is what we get eventually. Now we can do our final x. Our final x means A and not B or not A and B. So we are just going to connect these two things using the OR gate. So the OR gate is really the one going to connect the two together. So the OR gate says one of the inputs should be 1 for the output to be 1. So in the first row, we see 0 and 0, so the output's going to be a 0. Here we see 0 and 1, so the output's going to be a 1. Here we see 1 and 0, so the output's going to be a 1. Here we see 0 and 0, so the output's going to be a 0. So this is the OR gate because it says one of the inputs should be a 1 for the output to be a 1. So we have 0, 1, 1, 0. So we have finally finished the first Boolean algebra of the first first logic equation, we could say. First Boolean algebra logic equation. We've created a truth table for it. Now we need to prove. Remember, we're trying to prove that this part, this logic Boolean algebra, is basically equal to this one. So we're going to do the same thing again. Since we have two inputs, we're going to write it down. So we're going to do A and B again, and then we're going to put our 0, 4, 0, 2 zeros and 1s in the first column. And then we're going to, I need some space so that you guys can see. So 2 zeros and then 2 1s. And then here we're going to have 1, 0 and 1, 1. And then we are also going to check off what we have in our truth table so far. So what we have in our truth table so far, we already have the A and the B column, but we don't, and don't necessarily need anything. We just need this part of the equation. So we can just write that off. So we need A and B, and then we put a bar on top. If you want to break it down, you could do it this way, and then you could just basically do A and B, not that, and then you could do an X, because the X would basically mean that you're combining A or B with a NAND AB using the AND gate. So this is different. So now that you've constructed this truth table, this is the only thing that you needed. You can now again draw your lines just so you don't make a mistake with the outputs. So you know where you're tracing with the inputs. And then you can start your truth table. So A and B means 0 and 0. So that's going to give you a 0 with the AND gate. 0 and 1, again, that's going to give you a 0 because both of them have to be 1. 1 and 0, that's going to give you a 0 again, and 1 and 1, that's going to give you a 1. So now you're going to do not A and B, which is the NAND gate, if you guys remember. This is the NAND gate. So NAND gate means not A and B, which means everything you have here is the opposite. So 0, not 0 is 1, not 0 is 1, not 0 is 1, not 1 is 0. And now the X basically connects your A or B. Oh, I forgot to do the colon, guys, for the A or B. We need to do that one. I forgot to write it off. We don't have this colon together. So we need to create it. So A or B, and then we could do our X. So this is going to be our X colon here. So here we have our A or B. So if we wanted to find A or B so that we can do X, A or B, we're going to concentrate on A or B. The rule is that one of them has to be a 1 for the output to be a 1. So 0 or 0 is going to give us a 0. 0 or 1 is going to give us a 1. 1 or 0 is going to give us a 1. And then again, 1 or 1 is going to give us a 1. So this has achieved the OR rule. Now we're going to do X. So X basically is going to be this A or B connected with the NAND AB with the AND gate. So that means we're concentrating in A or B and we're concentrating on not A and B. So these two is our concentration and they connect together with the AND gate. So I think I can represent like a dot between them. So again, the rule applies. 1 and 0 is going to give us a 0. And then 1 and 1 is going to give us a 1. And then 1 and 1 is going to give us a 1 again. And then 1 and 0 and 1 is going to give us a 0. So eventually, if you guys notice, the output that we got in the first logic, first Boolean algebra, which was the first for the first equation, is 0, 1, 1, 0. And the output that we're getting for the second Boolean algebra equation is the same, 0, 1, 1, 0. So this proves that they are both equal. So this is what the question was asking you to prove, and you needed to do that with logic, basically true table. So we have just proven that they're both equal, and we've also understood how to create true tables by interpreting Boolean algebra statements into true table statements. So we're going to do more practice on this the next time we come, guys. We still have to learn how to do more logic circuits, more true tables from Boolean algebra and also from logic circuits. So we're going to learn how to do that next time. We're going to learn how to interpret logic circuits into true tables. What we did today was basically understand the logic gates and circuits and interpret the Boolean algebra into true tables. So stay tuned for the next video tutorial. And if you have any questions or suggestions, please let me know in the comment section. I'd like to hear from you and have a great day, everyone. Take care.